Good morning, and welcome to today's talk on Vertlantis and language learning in Second Life. Our speaker today is Kip Bone. He's also known as Kip Yellowjacket in Second Life. He's the co-creator of Vertlantis, a free language learning resource and community of practice in Second Life and Avanation. He's the co-owner of Oxford School for English in Germany and Austria. So let's get started.
Conversation than a presentation. I don't have a lot of visuals prepared for you. I've had a very, very busy week. Maybe that's not really a good excuse, but that is my excuse today. But I am here for you, and I'm here to answer any questions that you have. And I will let you know in chat here. I will use chat a lot today, so please look in the chat window, and I will also look at the chat window. So if you have questions during our conversation, please let me know in chat. Let's see here. Just to let you know at the very beginning, my email address is as follows, kip@vertlantis.com. And you can find information about Vertlantis on our website. I'll give you the link. It's easy to remember. It's vertlantis.com. And I would be more than happy to speak with each of you individually. So if you are interested in Vertlantis and you want to make use of it, or if you are interested in language learning in general in Second Life or in virtual worlds, I would be happy to meet with you individually to give you all a kind of info tour of Vertlantis. We have been active in Second Life since late 2006. The community has had different names over the years. We started off as calling ourselves Second Life English or Slinglish, and that name was changed over time. Actually, I should go further back. We started off calling ourselves ESL in Second Life, and then Second Life English, and then when our name was Second Life English, we often used the slogan "Do you speak Slinglish?" Which was kind of fun. And also, welcome to the revolution, because revolution with a focus on the E being evolution, because I do see the use of virtual worlds as a kind of step into the future in terms of where things can go in education. Our slogan that we now use is "Come speak with the world," and I'll type that. I think it's clear, but I'll type it. And our emphasis is very much on any and every language, and not only on language learning, but any and every subject. We see ourselves as acting as a free resource for language learners and language teachers, but we also welcome other subjects. So if a person wants to, for example, offer an activity for math or science or anything, geography, something culture-related, any and every subject is now welcome at Vertlantis, and we essentially provide free resources and free support, and we welcome everybody to see Vertlantis as their own. And when I say that, I really mean it. It is a gift or a kind of present to language learners and learners in general, and also, of course, educators. Just to give you a little bit of background information, I personally am originally from the United States, but I've been living in Europe for about, 13 or 14 years now. And my wife and I, we have a language school in Germany, but I am currently in Austria, where we also have a smaller language school. And Vertlantis is supported by our language school financially, so we are we pay the monthly bills, which we get every month, and our school, just so you know, is the Oxford School for English. But the emphasis is also not on that. So we don't try to use Vertlantis necessarily as a way of advertising the Oxford School. To answer your question, Nancy, I am originally from Washington, North Carolina, a very small, smaller city on the east coast of the United States. It's near Greenville. Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah. I'll go ahead and give you our school address, just so you know. And just to get back to this point, Yeah, we've never really tried to, how should I say, link the Oxford School and Vertlantis in a very official way. We don't really use it for advertising the Oxford School for English. So those things are really separate entities. The only connection at the moment is that a lot of the, yeah, the that the school and the teaching that I do in First Life helps to pay for Vertlantis significantly. And we also get donations, of course, from people, which are, of course, very, very appreciated. But that has also not been a focus of ours. We don't go out and ask for donations. We really want it to be a free resource. And it has been since late 2006. I want to pause now and just see if there are any questions. I will pause frequently just to allow this to be a conversation and not so much a presentation. Are there any questions about myself or about Vertlantis or anything that I've said so far that I can address now? I'll just pause for a second. No problem if there aren't any questions at the moment. Yeah, it is not a franchise. It is very much, I guess you could say, a family-run business. Not a business. Family-run school is a word that I prefer. My wife essentially bought the school back in 2000, in the year 2000. And long story short, we met in 2001, so I sort of worked myself into and married myself into that particular situation. So now we are both co-owners of the school. And I have since opened a smaller version of our school here in Austria. But it's very very small at the moment because we are not doing any public advertising. It's all word of mouth. So we haven't really officially launched the school here, and it's very small here. We have several teachers that work for us in Germany. And here in Austria, at the moment, it's just me. So the school is me. So very, very small. We are not a chain. We have about, on average, and it fluctuates, of course, but in Germany, we have on average between 10 and 15 teachers that work for us. And we do everything from offer evening courses at the school or any time at the school, also in-company lessons, translation work, online instruction and such things. And I also do a lot of freelance work, so I teach for other schools as well and also in companies. This talk is not so much about me, but I'll give you my CV in case you are interested in my background. That might help to answer some questions. And you will find that at this link here. Yeah. Okay, I see another question. Yes, I keep the questions coming because I really want to do this off the cuff, so to speak. I want to make sure that I deal with all your questions. Are your online teaching activities all in Second Life? Or both Second Life and WizIQ and other places? That's a great question. I personally have never seen Second Life as a standalone platform for e-learning. I've always seen it as a kind of add-on. Or a kind of supplementary platform for use with other tools, this actually relates very much to something that I will talk about later, something called cross-platforming or Web 2.0 scaffolding. There are different words for it, but the idea of using multiple platforms to deliver. A learning experience, essentially. We are very active on Facebook, and we've gone through several stages over the years. We've made use of ELG in the past, for example. We've made use of Ning at one time, and presently we are more focused on Facebook and Second Life, and using both of those together. And the reason for that is because most people are on Facebook, and so we try to go where the people are instead of making them come to us. There are, of course, advantages and disadvantages of doing that. But that's mainly what we do at the moment. We, of course, also make use of other tools such as Twitter and whatnot to spread information about our activities. But we are primarily active on YouTube, et cetera. We use just as a tip for everybody, we use tools like Hootsuite, which allow us to, and I need to use it more regularly now. I haven't done that recently, but these such tools allow us to spread information about our activities in Second Life and on Facebook more efficiently, so we can really get the message out. I'm just making sure I've addressed all the questions. Okay, great. Okay, yeah, TweetDeck is also nice. Also great. Okay, good. Let's see. Well, I want to make sure that I cover everything that I promised to talk about. So I've given you a little bit of history about Vertlantis. Maybe just to talk a little bit more about the nature of Vertlantis. The word sometimes confuses people. I hear people say Vertulantis, and you know, people mispronounce the word at times, which is understandable because it is a kind of created word. The word virtual is there. I want to show you it's a kind of wordplay. So the word virtual is there. The word virtue is there. The word versus is there. And also, of course, the word Atlantis. Yeah. Virtual is clear, I think, because we are in a virtual world. Virtue, because of the fact that it is free, and the aim is essentially to offer this as a free resource to people, and to facilitate free language learning and intercultural understanding. Let's see, versus is perhaps a little bit more unclear. What I mean by that is that there. If we look out there at the world and what's happening in the world, we see a lot of division, a lot of divisiveness, and attempts to split people and to divide people. And so we, or at least I, in my mind, wish to counter this and to basically bring people together and to facilitate intercultural understanding and trying to, you know, learn from each other about things directly. Versus getting our, you know, our information from other sources. I think this is one of the advantages that that a virtual world and the internet in general provides or provide, and that is that we can go to people. For example, Ukraine is a hot topic at the moment. If I wish to understand what's happening in Ukraine, I know several people in the Vertlantis community that I can go to ask for their personal opinion about what's happening. So I've always seen language learning as a way of building bridges for intercultural understanding. Thank you, Ola. That's the philosophy in a nutshell of Vertlantis. We don't only want to be present in the virtual world. We really want to branch out and be present in several places online. Right now, as mentioned, we are primarily present on Facebook and in Second Life, and also in the virtual world Avination, where we have a resource that is, and I'll be honest with you, at the moment it is mainly sitting somewhat dormant. It's ready for action, ready for activity. We do have a person, a teacher from Israel, who's planning on making use of that in the near future. But just so you know, if Second Life is not your cup of tea for whatever reason, Avination can be used, and we are mainly looking at using Avination in our island there for groups that need absolute privacy, so a kind of closed environment. So if that is something that interests you, please just let me know, and we can make that available to you. And with that resource, of course, comes tool sharing, and also tips and any and all support that you might want, with the emphasis on what you might want, because there is no desire to get in your way. Same is true, of course, in Second Life. If you decide to come offer an activity, we try to stay out of your way and let you do what you wish to do, and we meddle is the wrong word. We only come in to support when you ask for support, and of course to provide any resources that you might need. I think it's important to realize about Vertlantis is that when you go to the island, If you do not see resources or tools present, it doesn't mean that they are not there or that they cannot be provided for. I often say that in Second Life, and I think the same is true for First Life, or so-called real life, there is more than meets the eye. In every body's inventory, there is, of course, lots of potential, lots of resources that can be tapped into. And, of course, when we look at the many different activity organizers at Vertlantis, we call people who volunteer to teach another person a language or anything, an activity organizer. Every single one of those persons, also you know, including myself, has lots of experience to draw from, and so that in itself is a kind of resource for people who are getting started. Okay, yeah, we can go into the difference between Avanation and Second Life, no problem. Yes, it is this definitely a spirit of open learning. I personally have I guess very much influenced what I'm about to say. We choose to use words like activity organizer, activity participant, activity location, and we don't use words like student or teacher, or at least I don't. Other activity organizers can do that if they wish, but on the website, we try to use a different kind of language. And there's a reason for that. I see Second Life as being a platform which very much evens out the things in education. Let's see, how can I best say this? There's an attempt to have a little bit less hierarchy, I guess, involved in things. So everybody is a potential teacher. Everybody is a learner. And so we avoid language that might seem a little bit hierarchical or school-like, such as, you know, teacher-student. Depending on where you come from and what country you are from, you might, you know, better be able to understand what I'm sort of hinting at. But I don't want that to distract me so much. We do try to be an open platform for learning and to be very, very open to, yeah. Anything and everything. Let's see, I want to make sure I've dealt with questions. Yeah, holodecks are a great tool. We do use holodecks at Vertlantis, and just to touch on that a little bit, we are now actually looking at redesigning Vertlantis a bit, so the island in Second Life. And part of this new design will involve increased use of holodecks in unconventional ways. So, for example, we will try to avoid having a lot of permanent structures on the island, so to speak, and to instead holodeck our own structures, our own whatever buildings or whatever learning spaces or activity locations, so that we can quickly get rid of them or delete them. Excuse me. Whenever not in use, and of course anybody involved in Second Life realizes that the need for this for sim performance. When we use the word sim, we are basically talking about the virtual island. A holodeck, to answer that question, is essentially a tool which allows you to very quickly res an environment around you, the activity participants, etc., instantaneously. That has all kinds of advantages. So, for example, if I want to quickly make the area around me an office setting, I can do that. If I want it to be a jungle, I can do that. If I want it to be a cinema, I can do that. With just a few clicks of the mouse, I can make that new environment appear around me. And many users of holodecks in Second Life don't realize or are not aware of the fact that you can actually use this technology in different ways. So, for example, you can make objects appear, let's say quiz objects or quest objects or anything, discussion objects, anything. You can make objects appear anywhere on the island or the sim instantaneously. So, for example, I could be sitting on one side of the island, and let's say I have activity participants on the other side of the island doing something, and I want to inject or make appear objects for the sake of the activity or for whatever, I could do that. And just to give you a very quick environment, example of that, I once, just to sort of prove this point, I once placed a ship, a kind of pirate ship, for example, with treasure chests and things like that. And I was able to make the treasure chest appear and disappear with a few clicks of the mouse. I also set the ship on fire, for example, at the click of a mouse, and then I could make the fire go out. So you have the ability to add a sense of spontaneity to the environment. Of course, when speaking of quiz objects or quest objects, there's all sorts of possibilities. You could also link objects to things like Sloodle, which is basically the Moodle LMS or learning management system, an idea that I've had in the past and something that I've done in the past, but am not doing at the moment, and probably will do more in the future, is to have sets of quiz objects or quest objects that can be rezzed at any time, periodically, that would be linked to Sloodle, for example, or even other LMSs, that's also possible. So that if you wanted to invite people to come and simply walk around the island and interact with these objects, their data could either be, for example, their responses to questions could either be recorded or not recorded. For the sake of recording such information. Let's see. I want to check and see if there are any other questions. And please know that if you don't, if I don't cover things you want me to cover today, then simply send me an email and we can plan to either Skype or go into Second Life and deal with things individually. Yeah, Sloodle. I'm not a Sloodle expert. I have mainly used something in the past called SL ClearLine, and that was something that that I did with a friend, a programmer friend of mine. We aim to demonstrate that other LMSs could be used other than Moodle. But I don't want to get into that too much now because it is a rather technical. But long story short, we demonstrated with that that program that project that we could in fact have objects send data to another LMS other than Moodle. Essentially performing the same function as Sloodle. Does SL benefit you as a teacher? Absolutely, and not only as a teacher but as a learner. I use it. I have contacts. I mean, social networking alone is extremely valuable, right? So the ability to network with people from all over the world, and of course you can do that online too. You can do that anywhere. But I would argue in Second Life we often meet many. Creative people, intelligent people from all over the world, and also educators. A lot of the educators who are very active in Second Life are, more forward-thinking educators. So these are educators who are very often willing to try all sorts of new tools and technologies out there. And so the networking aspect alone is fantastic. And for one's own learning, it's the virtual world is a highly immersive environment. This ability to go into a virtual world and to really feel like you're there and to sit around, sit with people from all over the world and interact in such an immersive way is in my opinion just priceless. The average activity at Vertlantis has anywhere between, let's say 8 participants for lack of statistics, but we also have more at times or less, and we often have on average 8 people from different countries, which makes conversations extremely rich. We can have whether we are simply making small talk or big talk about more complicated topics. We very much benefit from that diversity and that immersiveness, the ability to feel like we are really sitting across from that person from Ukraine or that person from Russia or that person from China or the United States or anywhere. Let me see if I've skipped any questions here. Okay, great. So someone's going to show the holodecks, how to use them later. That's great. Being overwhelmed by all the technical details, there is of course a learning curve, and I actually have a list of so-called pros and cons of making use of virtual worlds for language learning. I'll try to pull that out for you in just a second and give you that list so we can use it for discussion. It's a very good point. There is a learning curve, one could argue. I think the learning curve has become a bit less steep over the years. Nowadays, if you go in and simply learn how to move around a bit, how to sit down, how to walk, how to speak, how to maybe adjust your voice settings, it's also important. With those basic skill sets alone, you can do a lot in Second Life, I would argue. There are some technical requirements, so the better your computer, the better the graphics card, the better your internet connection, the better the experience. That's something to keep in mind when in Second Life. So if you are offering activities for a number of people, we have to also think about their technical setup, their computer setup, and we need to realize that Johnny might be having a great experience, whereas Mary might be having difficulties. But I have tried to see this in a positive light over the years. I think that such technical difficulties also give us things to talk about and give us things to learn about together. So that's one way of looking at it. Okay, I'm looking at questions here. Great. Let's see. Just to maybe start to talk a little bit more about the nature of activities at Vertlantis. As mentioned, everything, or I think I've mentioned it, we deal with activity organizers, and it's all volunteer-based. Nobody is paid for anything. We are dealing with fantastic people such as Dex, who is here, or Dominique, as he is called here, who go in and basically offer their free time to help other people learn their language or learn about their culture or whatever. So it's all volunteer-based, and I see it as a kind of win-win scenario because a language teacher, for example, just to keep things a little bit more focused, a language teacher can go into go into Second Life, go to Vertlantis, and can learn more about the platform, and at the same time can help somebody. So there's a kind of give and take. And of course, when I go to activities, just in the discussions alone, I benefit from them significantly because I use Vertlantis, the Second Life, for my own learning. So when I, for example, go in and offer an activity, whatever the discussion might be on, whatever the nature of the activity, there tends to be some kind of payback to me as well in terms of simply learning and meeting very interesting people. And of course, it also, it's, I think, anyone who's involved in e-learning and is interested in the future of education, it benefits from this as well. I think it's good for educators to start to spend time with various kinds of online technology and figure out how to use things properly and creatively. Let's see. Another question: how do you agree on the time for the meetings? We do a number of things. We have an activity calendar, which is basically Google Calendar integrated on the website, on the Vertlantis website. So you can go to vertlantis.com and you can go to calendar there, and you'll see the activities listed. All of the activities are in so-called Second Life time, or SLT, which is essentially U.S. Pacific time. So we're speaking of, for example, Seattle or San Francisco time. Most of our activities at the moment are primarily, let's say, highly convenient for people living in Europe. But we have people, from all over the world, even South America, who manage to come and participate in the activities, even China. So despite the time zone differences, we still manage to come together. A future hope for Vertlantis is that we will manage to have activity on the island 24/7. That's maybe a bit of a dream at the moment, but I'm planning on reaching out to more people on Facebook, for example, various language groups and whatnot, and to simply let them know that they could see Vertlantis as an add-on to their activities on Facebook, and to try to get others coming in and using the platform. So that's something that we plan to work on in the future. Let's see. Yeah, thank you, Dominique, for the link. That helps a lot. Let's see. Maybe to touch on the nature of the activities a bit. I'm really going off the top of my head at the moment. Please forgive. I don't have anything in front of me, you know, acting as a compass, telling me where to go. So it's all just kind of coming off the top of my head. The nature of the activities. I'm also kind of going back, into memory because we're drawing from memory because we've been active for quite a while. Like I said, I've been active since late 2006, so it's sometimes hard to remember all the things that we've done. I haven't documented everything, but I probably need to start doing that more. Okay, a lot of our activities do tend to be stationary, somewhat stationary, but that doesn't mean that that's the only thing that's possible. At present, a lot of our activities are stationary simply because of the different the learning curve, for example. The fact that we deal with people who have different computer setups, different technical limitations, whether it be ability or related to hardware and things like that. So we have different activity locations on the island which can be used at any time. We are not limited to those activity locations. We can create new ones at any time. And as I alluded to or mentioned earlier, we plan to make use of holodecks in the future so that we can increase the number of activity locations that we can have on the island and make available at any time. So I think at present, I think we have about something like between 20 and 30 activity locations. Some of those have recently been removed simply because we are freeing up prims I can discuss that in a second if you want me to. Basically freeing up resources on the island so that we can start to redevelop a little bit. Okay, let's see. Let me give you a few concrete examples of some activities that I personally have offered over the years. And I may also mention activities offered by other activity organizers. Let's see. I once gave a very, very simple activity. I think the concept is extremely simple. It was called Res English. The idea of resing is simply to take an object and to make it appear. So you have an inventory, kind of like you could see it as like a suitcase where all of your things are in, you know, and you can take objects from your suitcase or your inventory and place them onto the ground or place them anywhere on the island. And essentially, we use that for conversation. So I took things out of my inventory. I encouraged others to take things out of their inventories, and then we use that for these objects to basically sort of spontaneously lead to conversation or give us something to talk about, essentially. I typically offer a kind of passive correction. I always ask for permission to correct people's English. My main focus in Second Life is English and helping people learn English. And so I often make use of B, for example, in chat, and B essentially means better. And I typically explain that is a friendly correction. Because once again, I feel it very, very important to avoid making the Vertlantis seem like a school-like environment. That said, that's my personal desire. Other activity organizers who might have a different way of thinking are free to do that and free to make use of words like teacher and student if they wish. The philosophy of Vertlantis that I personally am trying to promote is one of non-school-like, I guess. Let's see. Another activity was called movie night, and we essentially some of you may know, we have the ability to view video or even websites within the virtual world, which I think is fantastic. We haven't always had this ability. It's rather recent. What I essentially did in this activity was I grabbed links from YouTube. I looked for short animated films, for example, or videos, and I mean really short. So, for example, 3 to 5 minutes, or maybe 3 to 7 minutes. We watched these videos in the virtual world, and then we used that for conversation. Okay, let's see. Those are just a few examples. Okay, yeah, thank you. I'll do that. I guess I will be prompted, right, Nancy, if I need to expand my time? Okay, great. Yeah. One more mention of another activity that is actually ongoing at the moment. This is an activity that I currently offer. It's called Tea Time. It's also very, very simple to offer, I think. Another stationary activity, it's called Tea Time. And essentially, it's a conversational activity. It tends to be rather advanced in terms of the type of conversation that we have. We do tend to touch on a lot of so-called big topics, not only small talk, but big talk. And what I essentially do is encourage activity participants to bring their own conversation topics. And we sit in a very cozy environment, and we discuss those topics together. And of course, benefiting from the many different cultural perspectives present, so the opinions and ideas of people from various countries. And I act as a kind of moderator, so I try to keep the conversation flowing and make sure that the conversation is respectful and constructive. And yeah, that's just another example of an activity that tends to be rather stationary. Let me see if I can get away from these stationary activities and show you how Second Life could be used differently, because many people could and have made the argument that, oh, that's not really a very good use of Second Life or a virtual world. And I would agree. I think you can do a lot with virtual worlds, things which are a lot more creative and perhaps even more efficient. It's debatable, perhaps. Like I said, the stationary activities are often opted for simply because they tend to be simple for the participant or people who are new to Second Life. Activities that require more mobility tend to require more Second Life skills. You need to know how to teleport, how to get from one place to the other, and you need a computer that can handle that kind of mobility. The ability to troubleshoot voice issues, for example. If you go from one location to another in Second Life, your voice might cut out, so you need to be able to troubleshoot that. So those are just a few examples of the need to have more skills, I guess you could say, when carrying out such activities. But just to give you one example, another activity I've offered in the past, and also others have offered, involved traveling, so virtual world traveling, going from one location to another. And using other locations in Second Life as a learning environment, and this is something that I also personally have tried to encourage over the years to not see Vertlantis or any one sim or island as the only place within Second Life. Obviously, there's a lot more out there, and I personally have tried to encourage people to travel to go to different locations. And to use those locations for their activities. In activities that I've offered in the past, we've gone to different places. You can find cities, for example, cities like Berlin or Paris, etc. In Second Life, and just other sims or islands of interest out there, and you can go to those places and use them for discussion. I personally, and I say this in First Life too, I prefer the word First Life because or the term First Life because I see Second Life as, how should I say, I see Second Life as being just as real so-called First Life, because we are dealing with real people at all times. Yes, we have avatars that we use, these little figures, but I personally try to I see my avatar as an extension of myself. I do not see it as some kind of a toy that I'm moving around or some kind of a game figure. I see it more as an extension of myself, and I like that personally. I think it's a healthy way of looking at it. So I speak of first life. I don't want to lose my thread of thought, but I think I have. I'm looking at questions again, just to make sure I haven't skipped anything in chat. Yeah, please keep the questions coming if you have any. Let's see. Let me give you and I'm sorry that I'm all over the place, like I said, it's all from the top of my head, so if I misspeak or if I say something that doesn't make sense, just please forgive me. Just to give you an idea of other creative ways of using Second Life. I think when we are inside the virtual world, we often focus on you know activities, doing activities there inside the world, but we overlook the fact that we can also use this virtual world in other ways. Thank you, Katie. So for example, maybe Machinima is a great example. And I will assume that nobody knows anything about Machinima here, and just give you a little bit of information. Machinima essentially involves making videos, so using the virtual world for recording videos. Of course, you can take these videos and use them on platforms like YouTube and whatnot. I think video learning is a highly efficient way of learning about things. I personally consume a lot of videos on a daily basis. I think we should also look at virtual worlds from that angle, not only of what we can do inside the world, but also you know how we can use this tool as a way for learning, which can take place outside of the virtual world. Also, not only recording video, but making screenshots, right? Let me give you a more concrete example, and I don't want to say too much now. Not that it's a secret, but simply because I'm not ready to launch this idea yet, although it has already been somewhat launched. I'll explain. In the past, I also offered a kind of activity that involved role play, a kind of role play, which is common in Second Life. And please forgive me if this sounds a bit abstract, but I'm going to speak of this in a way so that the concept that I'm working on let me just talk. In the past, an activity which was offered at Vertlantis involved a kind of storytelling. I see Second Life as being a very powerful platform for storytelling. And there is a character at Vertlantis named Wiki Composer. I hope that you will hear from him more in the future, because this is a concept that I've been sitting on for a long time. I launched it, I guess, a few years ago. So when I say I launched it, what I mean to say is that Wiki came to Vertlantis and Wiki offered activities, and these activities were role play activities in nature, and it essentially involved chat based communication only. So no speaking in this case, and one of the main focuses was improving vocabulary, so vocabulary enhancement. Just to very briefly touch on that, as you all know probably, we can speak in Second Life, but we can also type and do a lot of chat-based communication. When I first joined Second Life, we didn't have voice. If we wanted to use voice, we had to use other tools such as TeamSpeak or Skype to somehow bring voice into the virtual world. I noticed a lot of advantages of you know only having text-based communication. One clear advantage is that you can, if you have a group of people, regardless of size, you can have several people communicating at the same time. And that's essentially what Wiki did, or what Wiki enabled. So Wiki is an avatar, and I don't only see him as an avatar. I want to stick to the. I want to give you some of his story and be true to his story here with you. So Wiki is a character that was essentially born in Second Life. He has a story. He does not, he's not familiar with the concept of First Life, or he's familiar with the concept, but he doesn't know what's happening out here. So his world is Second Life. He was born within that world. And I need to extend the, okay, I've extended the session. Hope that's okay. And so there's a very creative story there, and I can't give it to you in just a few minutes now. And please forgive if it doesn't sound so interesting. Trust me, I think it is. Wiki, the use of wiki and role play, I think will prove to be a very interesting use of Second Life for language learning. When I first joined Second Life, I did so because my wife and I were involved in a we were basically in the process of creating a kind of digital storytelling platform, which also was to have the name Verglantis. Okay, long story short, that particular project did not happen. We decided to terminate the project because of various reasons, and I instead started to focus on Second Life. And that's right, there's nothing on the screen at the moment. It's just a whiteboard, yeah. There's nothing there. No problem. Yes, it's very conversation-based today. Okay, so the initial idea for even joining, or the initial reason for even joining Second Life, was to really try to focus on the approach of using digital storytelling for language learning. And I still think that this has incredible potential. I think it's probably one of the better uses of virtual worlds. And my intention in the future is to bring Wiki back, and to be true to its story, and to really not divulge too much. I really mean bring him back. So Wiki is his own person. Wiki has his own kind of spirit, and Wiki allows. Me to do things which I could not do alone, and so what, without giving too much information, what we will see in the near future is a kind of website, or I'm not sure exactly where I will do it, but I will basically take stories from Wiki, which also that I may record of Wiki, for example, and this will be on a website, and. So essentially, you'll have the ability to interact with a story, a digital story, to learn in various ways, to learn new vocabulary, learn from Wiki's sentence structure, etc. All of the things that we need to learn when learning English, for example. And at the same time, you'll be able to teleport into the virtual world to have a bit of an immersive experience. So I've always been attracted to this idea of having a digital book that you could essentially use for learning, but you have the ability to go into that virtual world by the use of a teleport link, or Slurl, as it's called in Second Life, to sort of bring that story or that book to life, if you know what I mean, right? And I'm giving this idea because I have no desire to keep the idea for myself. I don't believe in that. I think we all need to spread each other's ideas and to allow other people to take those ideas and build on them. So I'm very happy to sit down with anybody and to explain the concept that I'm talking about. I chose the name Wiki Composer for this particular avatar because of the name, right? So Wiki, the idea that we all contribute to the story, right? It's Wiki-like. And Composer is, of course, related to composition. So the idea, in a nutshell, is that we will be composing the story together. People who participate in this, who wish to learn from Wiki Composer, can also contribute to the story, can influence the story with their own comments. So you can imagine, like on a blog format, where you can add comments and ask questions and whatnot. I also, Kip Yellowjacket, will be acting as a kind of a person who, kind of middleman, I guess you could say, so a person who comes in to sort of help with the more pedagogical aspects. Because the aim is to not distract from the realness of Wiki. Wiki's not a teacher. I think that has a lot of potential. I think all of you could also create your own stories or your own characters, right? I think we can look at all of these avatars as potential characters in a story. And like I said, with digital storytelling, we can learn from the book medium, and the book medium can contain graphics or images, and also video content, which also can act as learning learning instruments, so to speak. And then in addition to that, we can have the virtual world where a person can dive into the story, can go in, and I mean imagine this when reading a book, you turn the page and you see a picture, right? And you see in the picture maybe a picture of Wiki Composer, and Wiki Composer is somewhere doing something, right? And you read what Wiki Composer tells you, and Kip Yellow Jacket comes in and gives some assistance with the English and whatnot. But you can go and you don't only have that picture. You can actually go and teleport to that location and actually walk around and experience that environment that Wiki was in. So it's a way of kind of making learning a lot more experiential or experience-based, which I think is a huge advantage of Second Life. We can really link language learning to the experience, which is very good for retention, of course. In addition to linking language learning to an experience, in Second Life we can link language learning to an image, a visual. And this visual is not only static; it's not only a 2D image. It's a 3D environment that you can move around in and actually feel and experience. So I think in terms of making language learning more efficient, I think there's a lot of value there. Often in my first life lessons, I try to communicate the idea to students of mine that they should try to see every environment that they're in as a kind of learning environment. And I make the point that language is everywhere, and we even wear language, right? So I'm wearing a shirt, I've got a collar here, I've got a button here, I've got a beard here, so language is everywhere. And of course, in Second Life, we can make that point very, very well as well. Everywhere you look, there's something to talk about. Everywhere you look, there's language. And you can surround yourself with more or less language at any time with tools such as holodecks. In addition to that, just to mention Facebook one more time, and also in conjunction with Wiki Composer, Facebook will also act as a kind of we have a group on Facebook, a Vertlantis group, and that will also act as a kind of add-on to this experience. So the ability to go and simply ask myself questions, for example, or others, and that's essentially how we use Facebook now. We have a group. I'll give you the link, or perhaps Dex can give you the link to make it easier on me. But if you look for Vertlantis on Facebook, you'll find a Facebook page and a Facebook group. Please feel free to join the group. I invite all students that I have in First Life to make use of that group as well for asking questions about English and whatnot. The group is very, very multicultural, multilingual, which is the nature of Vertlantis and arguably also Second Life in general. Thank you, Dex, so much. So you'll also see language, different languages in use there. Many of our community members speak multiple languages. So we're dealing with not only language learners, language teachers, but people who are really polyglots. People who speak multiple languages. So you might see French in use there, German, Polish, English, etc. And that's also true in Second Life at Vertlantis. Although the dominant language is English, English is the so-called the primary meta language that is used throughout Second Life and also at Vertlantis. Great, Katie. Thank you so much. I'll go in and accept after this discussion. Guys, I could talk about this forever. Really, there's so much that could be said. I haven't even shared with you yet. I have a whole list of pros and cons of teaching in a virtual world. I guess we probably don't have time for all that right now. Just know there's so much more that could be said, so much more which could be discussed. So if you are genuinely and sincerely interested in getting active in Second Life and using it in some way, like I said, you don't have to necessarily be in there to use the world. Yeah, you could use it in other ways as well. Simply let me know, contact me, and I'd be more than happy to help you out. Okay, great. Yeah, I'm happy to stick around and keep the conversation going. Not a problem at all. I'll see if I can find the list of pros and cons very quickly for you. I think I have it in my inbox somewhere, and I'll paste that here so we could use that for discussion as well. For anybody who's interested in sticking around and talking some more, please keep the questions coming if you have any. I'm looking in my inbox now. See if I can find them. I think I see them now. Yes, I do. So I'll copy and paste these pros and cons. That this list is actually from years ago. I put this together a long time ago. I've shared it at various conferences and talks, and I think it's just it's good for conversation. I think most of these points still apply. Looks like I need to copy and paste in batches because the list is so long. So I'll do that. Please forgive me for using chat here. So here are some of the pros coming, and I'll keep the list coming. So here we are. So here are some, and I'll keep them coming. Let's see, multitude of manipulatives. Here are some more pros or advantages of the platform. I'm looking away at the moment because I have to make sure that I copy and paste everything and don't so here's some more. And I can give this to you in a note card or in an email if you wish. That of course would be easier. I should have typed this up for you. Please forgive. There's some more advantages. Here are some more. There really are a lot of advantages. Here are some more. Yeah, you'll have to scroll up and down to see this list. So that we can use it for discussion. I'll let you know as soon as I've finished copying and pasting so that I can then focus on chat and any questions that you have. So if you could just hold your questions a little bit for now, I don't want to overlook them. Almost finished with the advantages. Okay. I lost my connection. Can everybody hear me? Okay. Yeah? Good. Okay. Sorry about that. I don't know what happened, but I'm back. And here's the last bit of advantages. And you could add to this list, right? This is not a complete list. Maybe we can stop there, and we can always look at the cons later, and I could also mention some to you off the top of my head. Those are all of the so-called advantages of Second Life. Please maybe scroll up and down in chat and let me know if there's anything that you want to talk about. I'd be happy to elaborate on anything. No problem, Patricia. Yeah, you're welcome. Like I said, if you want to contact me for any reason, please feel free to do so. And I'll give you my email address again just in case. Okay, great. Yeah, so any questions about those so-called positives or advantages of Second Life, your virtual world language learning? Some of the points might not be very clear to you, so please let me know. And in the meantime, I guess I'll also talk about some of the cons. I won't copy and paste right now because I think what I'll do, Nancy, is I'll follow up this WizIQ talk and I'll paste a document where everybody can look at the list of pros and cons and contact me if they wish to discuss them. Well, let's focus on positives first. Why not? It's good to be positive too. Yeah, I'll do that. Okay. Yeah, I'll go through some of the pros just to kind of keep the conversation going. So with Second Life, we're dealing with a multinational, multi-ethnic, multilingual platform, which for language learning is fantastic. When I learned my first language, which was French, I only learned from textbooks. We didn't have the internet at the time, or at least I wasn't online. Later, of course, I went to France for a year, which is really arguably the best way to learn, when you actually can immerse yourself in a first life experience. But I would argue that second life, yeah, let's see. It's social networking in 3D, which is clear. It's a sandbox for highly immersive experiential learning. So most any conceivable educative scenario can be simulated or carried out. And really, it's up to a teacher or an activity organizer's own creativity, and of course other factors such as time and skill sets and whatnot. But so much can be simulated and carried out in Second Life. English is the lingua franca, so we can use English like we do in First Life as a kind of global language within the virtual world, which helps for facilitating activities between people who speak different languages. I touched on this earlier. There's a great potential for retention, so word retention, language retention, due to the ability to connect language with image, action, experience, and whatnot, to associate that. You have the ability to do some things which I've also alluded to, such as instantaneous virtual traveling, so the ability to go to different locations and to learn at the same time. Second Life, which is also true, I think, for online communication in general, is a less intimidating place to seek out casual conversation or conversation in general. The avatar helps us to. One of the things that helps us to do is to kind of avoid judgment. I mean, you can also, of course, judge avatars, but when I'm in Second Life with someone, I don't know if I'm dealing with a person who is, Caucasian, black, whatever, yellow, green, blue, whatever. I don't know who I'm dealing with. And so this removal of these things that we often use for, unfortunately, for judgment, the avatar can help to take those things away. Like I said, you can also judge a person's avatar. That can also be a mistake, right? We shouldn't judge based on appearance, but it is unfortunately a natural inclination. With the avatar, you have, in terms of language learning, you arguably have something, a kind of tool that makes confronting a person, a native speaker, for example, a lot less intimidating. So that's an obvious benefit. Let's see. You can interact with both native speakers and non-native speakers. Arguably, this is something that needs to be emphasized more in language learning in general. For example, when dealing with English, people don't only speak with native speakers. They speak with non-native speakers. A lot of the companies that I teach at here in Germany and Austria, the employees at these companies, they have to, for example, speak English with people from Hungary and Russia. And so a lot of the communication is non-native communication. And that's something that we can also practice in Second Life. Arguably, it's important for us to hear different accents and to get used to communicating, even when the English is broken. And it's also good for native speakers to practice this, in my opinion, to practice things like patience and listening and whatnot. Am I still okay? Is my audio okay? Can you hear me? I just want to check. Okay, great. Yeah, we have a wide range of accents, different ways of pronouncing language, which I've already sort of touched on. You have the ability to identify with your avatar and objects and others, so you can really, which this ability to identify arguably makes the learning experience a lot more immersive. You can experience and express personality, so with and you can do that in a number of ways, but of course with your avatar, that's very perhaps the most obvious example. You can really express yourself in terms of the way that you look, the things that you do, and so on. You can relate emotionally to your peers and also your mentors, That also is very, very related to the immersive experience. You feel like you're there, and it's a very real and arguably an emotional experience. Yeah, just like on the internet, you can find like-minded persons, persons that have common interests. There are all sorts of groups that you can join in Second Life. And I would really encourage anybody who goes into Second Life to look around and look for different communities so that you can really add some richness to your experience. Don't stay in one group only. Look around, find different groups that share you know that you have shared interests with, and yeah, try to join in their activities. Let's see. Yeah, there's potential for Second Life and real life carryover, and what I mean by that is that there's the ability we have the ability to do things in Second Life which can then have an effect on First Life. And a fantastic example of this is a project which I and Vertlantis is somewhat involved in, and that is Feed a Smile. This is not our own project; it's another a community that does this. I would encourage you to have a look at it. You can also find them on Facebook. Or simply Google it and you'll find information. And essentially they offer in-world concerts, concerts which are when I say in-world, I mean within the virtual world, within Second Life. These are live concerts offered by volunteers, volunteer musicians, and they raise money for a good cause, for feeding children essentially in Kenya, and also not only providing meals but building schools. They've actually built a real life or first life school with a lot of the not only with those funds but also donations that have been collected in Second Life. And that's just one very, very clear example of carryover into first life or real life. Yeah, you have the existence of support groups and mechanisms. You can find all kinds of groups which can act as support groups for various purposes, not only educational in nature, but also things related to health, support groups, and so on. You can experience both formal and informal learning in Second Life. So you can attend a kind of lecture-based activity, which would arguably be more formal, where you simply listen to a presentation. A lot of universities choose this model, or you could do something more informal. Which is more, I guess, more like Vertlantis. We tend to most of our activities tend to be highly informal in nature. A lot of interaction, and so on. You have what could be called educative congregating. So the ability to essentially meet other people in a cafe-like environment, for example, other educators, and simply sit and talk about things. So you don't have to have an official activity to do that. I'm checking chat again. Please forgive me if this is too long for everybody. If you need to go, don't worry. Like I said, you can contact me via email, and I'd be happy to help you. But I'll keep talking until someone tells me to shut up. Let's see. Yeah, team teaching and collaborative projects. In the past, another activity, just to mention it, we set up different locations at Vertlantis. And at each of these different stations or locations, we had an activity organizer or a teacher present. And the participants were asked to go from station to station and essentially interact with these different educators, which of course added a lot of flavor or diversity to the activity. They not only spoke to one person who had a certain accent, but you know, people from different countries and whatnot. So yeah, that's just an example of a collaborative kind of a project involving team teaching. Yeah, Second Life and ESL training. ESL, let's see. Okay, I've extended again. Today we are timeless. Time is irrelevant. Second Life and ESL training can be done at the same time. So, in addition to working on computer skills and Second Life skills, we can also improve language skills at the same time, right? I see that as an advantage. This idea of de-evolution, or I would argue evolution of teacher status, arguably Second Life has, you know, hierarchy has no place. Or at least in my mind, it doesn't. The idea of so this reinforces the idea that we are all learners. We all have something to learn from each other, and I think that is a good thing for education. I think that's the direction we need to go in. Let's see. yeah, the de-evolution or the evolution of the teacher role. So the idea that the teacher should be more of a facilitator of the learning process, not just teaching at the student, but really making the learning process easier in a very even way. Volunteerism, the ability to go in and volunteer. You can go in and assist all sorts of groups, groups which might interest you. Let's see. Trying not to mention things that I have mentioned already. There are a wide variety of different tools, so-called in-world tools or virtual tools that you can use within the virtual world to make the learning experience more interesting. Just to give you one example of a tool which helps me and helps for Atlantis, I think, there's a tool called My Smart Bus. I'll type that for you. You can also Google that. I think it's mysmartbots.com. And we essentially use that for communicating, for sending notices to groups in Second Life. So I can send a chat message or a kind of notice or message to 42 groups at the same time. It's a tool or service that you do have to pay for. That is not free, but it makes my work a lot easier. So if I need to cancel an activity, which does happen, like I said, our activities are volunteer-based, so we do ask for flexibility from the participants. There should be no pressure at Vertlantis. The idea is that there's no pressure. We have understanding for these volunteers. If a person needs to cancel an activity, that's just the way it is. The idea is that we should appreciate when we get something for free. So this tool, for example, can help us to communicate all sorts of information to a number of groups. And a holodeck is another example of an in-world tool which can be used. LMS integration or learning management system integration has already been talked about. Cost, you don't have to pay to be in Second Life. You can go in for free, which is good. Let's see. Yeah, you can possess things. This is perhaps a little bit more philosophical, but I like the idea of the fact that you could have something virtual or digital that you maybe cannot afford in First Life. I think this has a kind of psychological benefit. People who like shopping in First Life might understand what I mean. So if you cannot, let's give a very good example. If you cannot afford a Mercedes in Second Life, you can in First Life, you can afford it in Second Life, right? You might even be able to find a free Mercedes, for example, or a very nice dress that you cannot afford in First Life, you can have it in Second Life. And like I said, this is perhaps a little bit more philosophical, but I think there's some kind of a psychological benefit there, especially if the person is a person who knows how to appreciate. Then you can feel like you have things that you can use and experience without having to actually own them physically, which is, of course, also good for the environment and so on. What else? Second Life as a blended learning component, not a total solution. That's something we've already talked about. So the idea of combining Second Life with other tools and other platforms. In the past, I've also used tools like VoiceThread, for example. So we followed up our Second Life activities with a discussion with a VoiceThread. But there are so many different tools out there nowadays that you could use as a kind of add-on to the Second Life experience. You can communicate privately in Second Life, so you can have a private text-based communication or voice-based communication, and you can also have public communication, text-based and also voice-based. You can log out at any time. A lot of people, when they criticize Second Life, they say, oh, I would get lost in that world, I would spend so much time there, and so on and so on. But I think we need to realize that just like here with WizIQ, at any time I could log out. Same is true for a virtual world. We need to remind ourselves that we can log out at any time. It's important, of course, to do that. We do need real life and first life balance. I think that that's something that we need to remember, that is possible. You can get out any time. I think I've gone through most of the so-called positives or advantages of Second Life. A few more here. Here it says, Second Life offers opportunities for introspection, self-examination, and observation of others, and observation of behavior. This is also a little bit more related to psychology, I guess you could say. I think in Second Life we see a mirroring of First Life in many ways. Not only, we also see things happening in Second Life that don't happen in First Life. So, but in terms of behavior, we can see a kind of mirroring. For example, you can find people in Second Life who take Second Life very seriously, and you can find people who treat it as a game and don't see it as something serious, which I think also reflects what we see in First Life. Arguably, we can find people who take First Life more seriously, and then people who treat First Life like a game. I happen to be in the more serious category, even though I also believe in play and things like that. But I look at Second Life as a more serious medium or platform, and that's just how I choose to use it. So yeah, in terms of being able to use Second Life to reflect on First Life or real life, I think it has a lot of advantages there. We can look at behavior, avatar behavior or human behavior within the virtual world, and use that for discussion. A lot of universities use the virtual world for lack of a better word, psychoanalysis, et cetera, among other things, analysis of behavior. Just to touch on universities a little bit, universities tend some universities have had projects like that, which are, you know, related to behavior and psychology and whatnot. At Vert Lantis, we also try to facilitate language learning activities for universities. So we can fast track that experience for universities or a university professor, for example, who might want to be active in the virtual world, but might want some support simply because of time constraints, lack of experience with the medium or whatever, lack of resources. To give you a concrete example, I'm currently dealing with a person from California who is a Spanish teacher, and she organizes activities for people, for Americans who are or English-speaking persons who are learning Spanish, and I helped her by simply going in and creating the environments that she wanted for these activities, and then of course tweaking the environments anytime she needs that, and answering any questions that she might have along the way. So Vert Lantis can act as a kind of a way of making it very easy to use, or let's say easier to use the medium for an activity very quickly without having to go in and invest lots of time figuring things out oneself. I think that's one of the greatest things that we have to offer as a community, with an emphasis on we, right? Vert Lantis is not me. Vert Lantis is me, it's you, it's everybody that chooses to participate. And I don't have all the answers I don't have all of the solutions. But if I don't have those answers and solutions, I can turn to another community member, and I can get that person to assist, for example, and learn from them. Let me look at chat and see if there are any other questions. If I have missed your question along the way, please type it again so that I can respond to it. And I'll pause for a second to see if there are any questions. Okay, no questions yet. Okay. Let's have a vote. How many people want me to log out and stop this conversation, and how many people want me to continue talking? And like I said, we can stop at any time, so I'm not asking you to stick around forever. Just let me know. If one person is interested in me talking more, I'd be happy to stay for that one person. This will also be recorded in video format. Okay, so we have one vote for continue talking, so I'll do that. Let's see. Let's now maybe talk about some of the disadvantages of Second Life. Even though I don't want to focus on those too much, five votes. All right, nice. We'll touch on some of these disadvantages, but also get back to the advantages maybe and emphasize that more. One disadvantage tends to be, at least among not only among educators but people in general, is what I would call a skeptical versus gung-ho adoption. I will copy and paste some of these cons or disadvantages in chat like I did before so that you can see. Yeah, so skeptical versus gung-ho adoption, I would describe as being, you have some people who look at Second Life and you know, without even thinking much, their initial reaction or their spontaneous reaction is either, yes, that is fantastic, I can use this, wow, I appreciate that that platform, I can see how I could use this in so many ways, thank you, this is wonderful. And people who get in and start using the platform, you know, without being skeptical at all. And then you have people who look at something like this and say, what is that? Is that a game? Is that a waste of time? Oh, that looks too difficult for me. So those are people who are more skeptical. I personally am more in the gung-ho or highly enthusiastic and passionate camp or group, for lack of better words. And I was like that, I've been like that from the very beginning. So when I first logged into Second Life, I saw the potential, even though back then we didn't have voice. I started creating basic, you know, prims. A prim is essentially the basic building block of Second Life. So if you can imagine a kind of like, Lego-like object, I created a kind of screen. I started putting textures on the prims, and doing very, very basic and simplistic activities. So, for example, you know, taking a screenshot of something on my computer and putting a texture on the object, and then using that and offering a kind of lesson-based activity where I simply, tried to help people with English. Now you can do so much more in Second Life, which is really fantastic. But like I said, I did not look at it skeptically. I started making use of the platform without focusing on the perceived disadvantages. I immediately saw the advantages. I don't want to focus on this too much because I think we do have a number of ways of dealing with such problems. But you can also experience things called griefing, or people who essentially want to disrupt what you are trying to do in Second Life. But you can also experience that here in First Life. There are arguably also such distractions here. But we have tools for dealing with such persons. You can make activities private in Second Life. You can make it so that, for example, any activity location at Verglantis can be made a kind of closed or access-only environment where we have only certain people on the list who can enter. But lately, that's not been necessary. We generally keep the island open. At times, we do close the gate, so to speak, or make the island group access only if we perceive that there's some kind of a problem that we need to deal with, such as griefing. And just so you know, you should join the UWA Verglantis group if you are interested in participating in activities in Verglantis, at Verglantis, because sometimes we do, like I say, close the gate so that only members of the group can enter. But generally speaking, that's not necessary, and our activities are open to the public, and we experience very few distractions. In the event of distractions or problems, we have various tools and various ways of dealing with it. So not a problem. Let's see. Other disadvantages, we've already talked about the learning curve. I think that is a disadvantage in some ways, but it can also be seen as an advantage. Learning is a process, right? So if there is a learning curve, that means that we have lots of new things to learn, right? Which means lots of content, lots of material, lots of experiences along the way that we can look forward to. That said, I can also understand the frustration that a lot of people do experience when they log in and they realize, oh, wow, question marks are everywhere. What do I do here? How can I do this? How can I do that? I can understand how that can also be frustrating for people. I think Second Life is a platform which is ideal for people who are very passionate about learning, who are very persistent learners, and people who are willing to troubleshoot different problematic situations. and to really realize that, okay, I'm dealing with the process here, and I cannot expect to have a totally user-friendly experience at all times. I may confront obstacles along the way. Okay, and of course, also people who are more technically and computer inclined, arguably a person who has problems using Skype or something very basic, arguably Second Life is not for them. I'm not saying that's necessarily the case, but let's just say that the learning curve might be, or the technical obstacles that you might confront, or you do confront with Second Life are, you know, far outnumber the problems that you might experience with easier platforms or tools such as Second Life, such as Skype or Facebook and so on. Let's see. At the very beginning, I noticed a kind of trend, and I suspect this trend is still present, even though I've experienced it less over the years, less and less. And that is that the tendency for certain people to basically, and I'll paste that here, to keep secrets, to keep information to themselves, and we also see this in First Life. So so-called know-how hoarders and traders and sharers, you have people who, for example, know a lot about Second Life, but they don't want to tell you, right, how to use Second Life. They don't want to transfer their skills to you because that takes away the advantage that they might have, right? I'm definitely not that kind of person. I am more in the traders and sharers category. I believe in freely, giving information and assisting others, I don't like this tendency for some people to keep the skills that they have private and to use that in a kind of selfish way. So that might be something that you also confront along the way. You might meet people who simply don't want to assist you, also because of so-called noob phobia. A noob is like a person who is new to Second Life. People who have more experience in Second Life might be reluctant or less inclined to want to assist people who are very, very new to the platform for various reasons. Maybe they're too busy, or they've heard the questions too many times, or for whatever reason. But at Verdlantis, we've tried to promote a different kind of a different way of thinking. The idea that people who join the platform, they need assistance, and so we do try to provide that assistance. In various ways, not only within the world of Second Life, we also Skype with people about Verdlantis, talk with them on Facebook about it, and so on. So arguably, at Verdlantis, you will experience less of that. We tend to be a very welcoming community for newcomers. Let's see. Time zone confusion can be an issue. But this is also an online problem or an internet problem in general. In Second Life, we deal with people from all over the world, so from various time zones, so that's something you do have to prepare for. And luckily, there are tools such as timeanddate.com, I think is the address, and if you Google time zone converter, you'll find lots of different tools that you can use, which help to get everybody on the same page time-wise. So that there's not too much time confusion. Let's see. The teaching format and determining group size, the ideal group size, could be an issue. In the past, I've offered activities that my activities tend to be open in nature, an open format. And what I mean by that is that anybody can teleport in and join the activity at any time. In the past, I had 20 or 30 people that would show up, for example, at activities. That doesn't happen so often now. I'm referring more to the peak period. So Second Life experienced a kind of peak in terms of activity, where we had a lot of educators and people curious about the platform, logging in and checking it out. And so we often had problems dealing with these huge numbers because of the open format. But one way of solving that is to have, if needed, a closed format where you simply have people indicate that they are interested in it, and then you put them on the access list, and then you close the environment so that only people on the access list can enter. And then you can limit the size of the group that you deal with if that is deemed or seen as necessary. But like I said, you know, lately that's not been an issue for me. On average, I have personally, I have, you know, 8 to 10 participants or 6 to 10 participants. And yeah, so that is not an issue. Let's see. When dealing with teachers or activity organizers at Verglantis, for example, you could experience a so-called certified an actual professional teacher or a person who's not an actual teacher in First Life, which I personally do not see as a problem. I personally don't put a lot of value on the idea of being certified officially or anything like that. I think experience you know, tells us more about a person's level of competence. But just to give you an idea of what you might confront when dealing with an activity organizer at Verglantis, you might be dealing with a person who's a professional teacher, who has lots of experience, who is a native speaker, for example, or a non-native speaker. You might also be dealing with an academic, a person from a university who is more interested in research, but of course also comes with a lot of experience and knowledge. You might also simply be dealing with a non-native speaker who does not have a lot of teaching experience, but wants to use the platform for helping others learn a language, who may not speak perfect English or perfect French or perfect Spanish, but nonetheless is willing to spend time with other people to learn together and to help, when possible, that person learn a language. And I personally see room for all such persons. You're welcome, Anna. Thank you for joining us. So I personally see this as a great thing that we can bring all these people together in this kind of informal lifelong learning environment. Okay, I'll keep talking until you guys tell me to stop. Let's see. Yeah. Number of predefined activities. I personally think activities is where it's at in Second Life. If you want to go in and do something of value, I think it should be activity based. Ideally, I think people are looking for activities. So it's of course nice to create something which can be used, such as like a quiz or quest like environment that people can log in and use at any time. That's also interesting for learners. But I think in general, people are looking for activities. They're looking for a social learning experience. So my advice to anybody starting their own language learning community or any learning community is to focus on activities, to offer as many as possible, and to really put a lot of emphasis on that. Just to talk about Verglantis, when you look at our calendar, the activities that we have on offer may fluctuate and does. So sometimes we have lots and lots and lots of activities on any given day. Monday happens to be one of our most active days at the moment. We might have 5 or 6 activities on that day, for example. But on certain Mondays, we might only have 2 because certain activities have been canceled. Maybe there's a holiday and people, you know, because of that need for real life, First Life, Second Life balance, need to be elsewhere and not online. So it's very important to look at our activity calendar and to be aware of when activities are on offer. Most people come to Verglantis when we have activities. We don't want to waste anybody's time, so we don't necessarily try to keep people present on the island all the time. You do see that still in Second Life. You might go to an island, they might have hired somebody or have a volunteer who stays on the island at all times just to have someone there. Okay, I'm back. Audio okay? Is the audio okay? Can you hear me? Great. No, it's okay. I'm on a roll, I guess, now. I personally do not want to waste anybody's time. I don't want Verglantis to be pressure for anybody. It shouldn't be pressure. There should be no pressure on the activity organizer. There should be no pressure on the participant. So we don't in any way try to require or to encourage anybody to just stick around and hope that somebody shows up. We encourage people to come to the activities when we have activities. And otherwise, our activity can take place elsewhere. So Facebook, for example, is where we often are active with each other as a community when we are not inside the virtual world. And of course, it doesn't have to only be on Facebook. We also are on Google+. We're also on Twitter and et cetera. So there are various ways for the community to kind of interact. Yeah. Let's see. What else can we talk about? Yeah, this is perhaps an interesting point. I don't think it's a disadvantage, but for some people it might be. But there's no dominant standard in terms of like so-called American or British English. I've always found these categories rather simplistic. To be honest with you, I think there are many more categories of English than just so-called American and so-called British English. We can think of, for example, Irish, Scottish, South African, Canadian, et cetera, et cetera. And the fact that English is a global language means that we are dealing with many different kinds of English. And I think Second Life helps to bring all that together. And of course, this is also true for the internet in general. So I think a good language learner, especially a good English learner, should try to increase exposure to all these different ways of speaking, which means different accents and different use of vocabulary and whatnot. I think it has enriched the English language. I don't think it takes away from the English language. I think it has enriched it, and I see it as a positive. Obviously, it adds to complexity, right? So that point I also understand. Another disadvantage that you might perceive is you know, how to correct people or how to offer correction. I think that because Second Life is an informal learning environment, it's not, you know, when you log in there, you don't log in and say, oh, this is clearly a classroom environment, or this is clearly a learning platform. Actually, when you first log into Second Life, when you sign up, you often have the impression that it's a game, because they use words like play, play now, which I think is a mistake. But that's another topic. So how can you correct people? How can you sort of play the teacher, so to speak? And one way to do that is, of course, to ask for permission to correct mistakes. I think most of the people we deal with do, in fact, want us to give them correction and to give them tips. But I think this needs to be done in a delicate way. And, of course, it's hard to do this with voice if you have lots of people involved in an activity. It's easy to, like, speak over each other, you know, to speak at the same time. And so that's one reason why I personally choose to use chat. And to, as already mentioned, to use the B, which simply means better. That's the approach that I've taken, and that has worked for me over the years. I also use, to mention another tool, there's a tool that I use called, I can't think of the name at the moment. I think it's called Workbench or something. I'm not sure what the name is, but anyway, it's a kind of recording tool. For example, at tea time, because we confront a lot of vocabulary, I often type an asterisk next to words which I think might be new to the participants, or a word which might simply need to be thought about some more. Every word that I type with an asterisk gets recorded with this tool. And then I can do a playback at the end of the activity, and then I can see in chat, in the chat window, I can see all of the words again, and then I can copy and paste all of those words that I have recorded with that tool, and then put them in a Google document, for example, and then after the activity, I can share that Google document, make it so that the document can be edited if people want to go in and for example, translate words or add to the document or correct my typos if I make typos, which does happen as well, and so on. So that's just another example of a tool that can be used in Second Life. Do-do-do-do-do. Yeah. Now, here's another interesting point, which can be perceived as a negative or a disadvantage. Concurrent or simultaneous communication between natives and non-natives can indeed be problematic at times. I can recall activities in the past in which native speakers, not language teachers, not language learners, but native speakers simply decided to come and join in on the conversations. And for a person who's not a language learner, it might be less apparent or less clear that one needs to speak clearly, for example, that one might need to slow down, that one might need to be more patient, that one might need to avoid complex or difficult vocabulary and to use a simpler, easier words and simpler vocabulary. Slang is a great example. So this the fact that we are dealing with both non-native speakers and native speakers at the same time is an advantage in terms of offering opportunities for that real experience of what language really is like, outside of the textbook. Yeah, but it can also lead to some complications. So I think it is a good idea to have a kind of moderator or a person who is moderating the conversation to make sure that things stay respectful, to make sure that confusions are explained, and so on. So that's something to think about. Here's another perceived disadvantage by some, and that is that there are some people who prefer text, who don't want to, text-based communication, chat-based communication, and others that only want to speak and don't want to type, or people who use both. I am the latter. I tend to use both, and I see advantages of using both. But you can also meet people in Second Life who don't want to type, who don't want to chat with you, or what is more likely, you might find people who don't want to speak with you for whatever reason. Fair enough, okay? It's their choice. But be aware that you may confront that. You might find people who only want to use text-based communication. And like I said, there are many reasons for this, but I think one reason for this is the fact that Second Life started out as a text based platform. Voice was not an option, and so many people got used to that, and many people feel like it takes away from the immersiveness, for example, in role play, yeah, to use voice. And I think there's some validity to that, some truth to that. And when I mentioned Wiki Composer, I indicated that he does not speak, and there are reasons for that, because it would take away from the realness of the Wiki Composer experience, so to speak. Yeah, in order to keep the spirit of Wiki Composer alive, Wiki needs to only speak. And to be honest, just to keep a spirit alive with you now, he can't speak because he's limited to the virtual world. He that's his environment. So he cannot communicate to with us in that way. But I, Kip Yellowjacket, can act as his voice, right? So I can add voice to the things that he says via text-based communication. Okay, let's see. Yeah, maybe one more thing, and then I'll stop. That probably will be enough for today, even though I haven't touched on everything, if you can believe that. There really is so much to talk about. You do have people, so-called real life or first life escapers, versus people who combine the two worlds. I personally am, once again, the latter. I choose to see Second Life as an extension of First Life. I don't see Second Life as a place where I escape First Life. I do go in at times and see it as simply an environment in which I can, meditate or reflect or relax, of course. But I've never seen it as a place to escape. But you do have people who do that. You do have people who go in to escape and perhaps also have problems with escapism. But I personally am not affected by that. And some people don't like to reveal their first life or real life identities in Second Life. They want to be anonymous for whatever reason and to only use their avatar. And there are various reasons for that. And that can also be respected, and it is something that I respect. I think people have a choice of whether or not to do that. I personally choose to let people know who I am in first life, and also who I am in second life. And as you may have noticed, I use the same name, the same first name. Kip is my first life name and also my second life name. Yellow Jacket, just to let you know, is simply a name that I chose from a list. When I joined it in 2006, there were some predefined or predetermined names, that surnames or last names that I was able to choose from. And I just by chance happened to choose the name Yellow Jacket. And I have used that name now since 2006. I also have other avatars that I use for different purposes. It's also something that I would recommend to you. For example, I have avatars that I use for machinima purposes. If I need additional characters in the videos that I make or in the snapshots that I make, I can bring in, I can log in other avatars at the same time, and then use them. Instead of, if I can't manage to invite other people to help me with things, I can use multiple avatars at the same time. Also, just to be very honest with you, over the years I've managed to I've been lucky enough to meet so many people and to offer friendship to so many people that my friends list is now very, very long. My contact list is extremely long, and so I have a lot of people who contact me all the time for just to say hello or because they need something, which is wonderful, but it also keeps me busy. And so that's also another reason that I have alternate avatars. So if I need to log in to quickly make a video, for example, or to do something, and I don't wish to be disturbed, then I can do that with another avatar. You can also do that with your main or primary avatar. You can use what's called busy mode in Second Life, so you can make it so that essentially what happens is if people contact you, an automated message gets sent to them and lets them know. Okay. But I have found it over the years advantageous to do both, to use busy mode when needed, and also to have an alt or an alternative avatar when needed for different things. Yeah, guys, I could continue forever, I think. It's really hard to summarize the Second Life experience, especially when you've been in there for a long time. So I will try to bring this this discussion to a natural conclusion, and just wait and see if there are any last questions. And once again, invite you to contact me if you have any questions, or if you wish to simply be fast tracked and to have a look around Vertlantis. I'd be happy to do that with you. And like I said, we can do this either via Skype, WizIQ. I'll go wherever you want to go. So if there's a tool of choice that you wish to use for an initial, kind of a talk or a follow-up talk to this discussion, I'd be happy to go wherever you wish to go to have that conversation. Great. Thanks for the positive feedback, guys. And like I said, I really improvised this time. I didn't prepare a lot because I've been so busy. But improvisation, I think, is also something that we need to get used to, especially in places like Second Life. Such platforms arguably require the ability to improvise a lot. So, great. Okay. Well, thanks again for your time and for coming. And I hope to hear from you. Feel free to offer friendship, and feel free to contact me via email or whatever. Okay, and Nancy, if you wish to take over, or if you want to stop the recording at any time, please feel free to do so. Okay, great. I'll do that then. I'll stop the the recording and simply say goodbye to everyone. Let me see if I can find the, let's see, there it is, the in class, I see it. Okay, thanks again for your time, everyone, and yeah, I hope to see you soon in Second Life, perhaps at Vertlantis, if not somewhere in Second Life. Take care, everyone. Hasta luego. Abianto. Bis bald, ja? Till soon.